everybody, and welcome back to another Wheel of Time video. In today's video, we're going to be taking a look at the top 10 best moments in the Wheel of Time. Now, I can tell you this was a very tough video for me to make, as it was really hard to narrow down my favorite moments. I really do have tons. But before getting into the video, I want to let all of you know that this video is brought to you by Oren the Elf, one of my fantastic supporters over on Patreon. Oren is a top tier supporter of the channel, and because of his support, he gets to choose a video for me to make. This is his first choice. Thank you so much, Oren. Also, another major supporter of the channel is Audible.com. If you are not already an Audible member, they are giving out a very special offer to my viewers. You can get a 100% free audiobook from their collection of thousands and thousands, and support the channel at the same time. How do you do it? Easy. Just head over to www.audibletrial.com/Nablus and sign up for a 1 month free trial. You do not have to keep the service, yet you can still keep the book. I do highly recommend keeping it though, because you get another audiobook every month. If you haven't been through the Wheel of Time's audiobooks, then you are really missing out. It is a totally different experience than reading them, and I highly recommend it. And also, just by signing up, you are really helping out the channel. So let's kick off the video by throwing up a spoiler warning. This video will carry a spoiler rating of red, meaning it will have major spoilers all the way through the final book. Please watch at your own risk. So in diving into the top 10 best moments in the Wheel of Time, I really look for moments in the series that either gave me goosebumps when I read them, got me fired up and excited to read that section again, or were simply left me very emotionally touched. As I said earlier, the series had so many of these moments that it was really hard to narrow this list down, but here's my best shot. We'll kick it off with number 10. Matt beats both Gawain and Galad. So this moment isn't a particularly pivotal one or anything, but it was the first real moment where we get to see Matt shine in sort of a badass role. Up to this point, he had essentially been possessed by the Shatter Logoth dagger, and right after his healing, he heads down to the White Tower grounds where he sees the warders training and sees Galad and Gawain training with the sword with a whole bunch of female onlookers. Matt, right in character, bets them that he can beat them both together with a quarterstaff. Galad and Gawain are super cocky, and they proceed to get their asses handed to them by Matt with a quarterstaff. They are seemingly embarrassed in front of all of the onlookers, and they have to pay Matt. This scene really strikes a chord with me, as it's always fun to see that those that hold themselves so highly get knocked down a few rungs. Galad and Gawain clearly look down on Matt and believe that they are superior to this farmer. Again, not the most pivotal moment in the series, but it sets the tone for Matt as a character for the rest of the story, and this is the first time that we really see him for the badass that he is. At number 9, Fael comforts Perrin. This is one of the more emotional moments of the series to me, and I think the place that the Perrin-Fael relationship became very real to me. I know they get a lot of hate, especially later in the story, but this to me was a very real moment. During the fourth book, Perrin discovers that his family has been slaughtered, all of them. He's left without any surviving close relatives. We see him try and put his duty ahead and the grieving aside and feeling as though he has to continue on. And we see a genuinely touching moment where Fael holds Perrin. And this simple and touching moment triggers Perrin's grief to come out all at once. You can feel the weight of the loss that he must feel. And you can see the genuine care for Perrin from his future wife. Hate this relationship all you want, but this moment felt super real and hits me hard every time I read it. Number 8, Rand saves Meridon. I loved this sequence the first time I read it, and every time I've reread the books, I look forward to coming to this chapter. To recap, Rand left Rodal Iturralda and his Damani to defend Saldaea, and had seemingly forgotten about him. Rodal Iturralda, one of my favorite side characters in the entire series, does a masterful job of staying alive and dragging out the engagement with the Trollocs in Saldaea. Just when all seems lost, Rand, who has now become Zen Rand by having merged with Luzthaeran Telamon while atop Dragonmount, shows us the full power of the Dragon Reborn. He arrives and secures the city with a force of Saldaeans and Ashaemen, and then rather than just retreating, he decides that he will end the army of the Shadowspawn himself. He travels outside of the city of Meridon and unleashes a storm of light, single-handedly destroying an entire army of Trollocs. Yes, this is overpowered. Yes, this is a bit powerful even to do for Rand, but I loved seeing the full power of the fully realized Dragon Reborn annihilate an entire army. The hope that this inspired and the soldiers that witnessed Rand's actions was contagious, and for the first time for many of Rand's forces, it seemed like they had a chance in the last battle. Number 7, Moraine returns. This was one of my most anticipated moments coming into the final book. Moraine was one of my absolute favorite characters in the entire series, and I desperately wanted to see her make a difference in her return. I was not disappointed. After being rescued from the land of the snakes and foxes, Moraine's appearance at the Field of Marilor and subsequent saving the day was really exciting to see. It wasn't just her words and the calming influence that she had on the many rulers in the room, but it was also amazing to see how Rand's reaction to seeing his old mentor again. Nynaeve's reaction was also one of my favorite, a begrudging acknowledgement that Moraine had been right, and Nynaeve's massive amount of respect was obvious. I loved having her back in the story. Number 6, Egwene defends the tower. I really loved all of Egwene's arc as she undermined Elaida's reign as Amyrlin from the inside of the White Tower. This culminated as the Shan Shan attack, and Egwene leads the defense of the White Tower while under the influence of Forkroot, but yet linked with 12 novices. This was one of many truly badass Egwene moments throughout the books, and watching her take revenge on the Shan Shan and single-handedly lead the resistance was a lot of fun to read. I love that she built authority not based on position, but based on the respect for who she was and the strength of her character. It was then very fulfilling to watch her demonstrate her strength as a fighter as well. Number 5, the cleansing. To me, this moment was a great culmination of a number of plot lines and was a very satisfying payoff to an otherwise slow-paced book in Winter's Heart. I loved the weaving together of many different plot lines, the first time we generally really see men and women working together wielding the One Power, and the overall hugeness of what Rand and Nynaeve were doing. The beacon that he was sending all over the world would be felt through the next book in Crosswords of Twilight as well. This was a huge event. I loved seeing the different battles with the Forsaken throughout the chapters, and seeing actual consequences as characters died and Rand was defended. The reason that this makes my list so highly is that we get to see many different characters have badass moments all at one time. Rand and Nynaeve, obviously, but also Olivia, Varen, Cadswain, Narishma, and even the Forsaken. It's one of my favorite moments in all of the books. Number 4, the Golden Crane flies for Tarmon Gaiden. This moment almost brought me to tears the first time I read it, and it did bring me to tears when I listened to it in the audiobooks, and I'm not an emotional guy. I don't know how you listen to Michael Kramer reading Nynaeve's demand to the Malkieri merchant while in Saldaea to ride with Lan and not get goosebumps. His breath caught, and he stretched out a hand, brushed a finger across the heavy gold signet ring on a cord. Across the crane in flight. How had she come by this? Under the light, how? I recognize it, he told her, his voice suddenly hoarse. My name is Nynaeve Te'Amira Mandragoran. The message I want to send is this. My husband rides from World's End towards Tarwyn's Gap, toward Tarmon Gaiden. Will he ride alone? He trembled. He did not know whether he was laughing or crying. Perhaps both. She was his wife? I will send your message, my lady, but it has nothing to do with me. I'm a merchant. Malkyr is dead. Dead, I tell you. The heat in her eyes seemed to intensify, and she gripped her long, thick braid with one hand. Lan told me once that Malkyr lives as long as one man wears the Hodori and pledged that he will fight the Shadow. So long as one woman wears the Kaisane, pledged that she will send her sons to fight the Shadow. I wear the Kaisane, Master Aldragoran. My husband wears the Hodori. So do you. Will Lan Mandragoran ride to the last battle alone? He was laughing. Shaking with it, and yet he could feel tears rolling down his cheeks. It was madness, complete madness, but he could not help himself. He will not, my lady. I cannot stand surety for anyone else, but I swear to you, under the light and by my hope of rebirth and salvation, he will not ride alone. Goosebumps. Every time. There is something about honor, loyalty, sacrifice, and the need to make things right that inspires you. And this is one of the reasons that this series is so damn good. Number 3, Varen's reveal. So another equally badass moment in the series is Varen's reveal to be of the Black Aja. When she blatantly lies to Egwene after Egwene tries to dismiss her, it slaps you in the face and gets your attention. Varen was also so mysterious, and her motives were always a mystery. So to finally see not only what she had been up to, but also how heroic her character arc and story had been, I don't know that you can keep this from a list of the top moments in the series. This is also so pivotal to the Light's ultimate victory, as she almost single-handedly destroys the Black Aja from within, by exposing it and helping cleanse the White Tower. Varen was always a badass, but this reveal proved beyond any doubt and cemented her as one of my absolute favorites. Before getting into our top two, let's go ahead and take a look at some honorable mentions. Nynaeve beats Mogideon. Lan defeats Demondred. Moraine's story about Manetherin. Rand's epiphany on Dragonmount. Perrin forges his hammer. Tam and Rand reunite. Nynaeve heals Loghain. Number 2, The Way Back Tirangriol. This almost took the number 1 spot on my list simply because it was the most interesting moment in the entire series to me. Seeing Rand make his way through the glass column Tirangriol at Roedion, and seeing the gradual history of the fierce Aiel people all the way back to the fall of the Age of Legends and the beginnings of the breaking of the world was not only surreal, but it gave a new depth to the series as a whole. This expanded the world building to another level. Beyond just having different cultures and nations, we got to see a culture evolve over time. But in reverse order. It was genius writing and masterful execution. This scene is one of the highlights of the series and is one of the main reasons that The Shadow Rising is my favorite book in the series. This is a complete masterpiece of fiction and one of the greatest passages in fantasy writing of all time. Number 1, Dumai's Wells. How could this not be on the list? This battle was the coming together of a number of plot lines converging into one single pivotal moment that changed the trajectory of the characters and the world within the series. We see the absolute destruction that the One Power can cause. We see Rand develop PTSD and struggle with sanity before breaking free from torture and captivity. We see warfare forever changed within the world of the novels. We see the infallibility of the Aes Sedai completely ended. Mazrim Taim delivers two of the more iconic lines in the books within this same sequence. First, under orders to disperse the Shido Aiel, Ashaman, kill, which was followed by the absolute annihilation of the Shido attackers, as their bodies are literally exploded all over the battlefield. The second line occurs after the battle. Kneel, or you will be knelt. For the first time in the history of the series, Aes Sedai now serve someone other than themselves, and the world is forever changed. So these are my top moments in the series. There were literally so many I left out that I could have made a top 50 list. Seriously. I would love to hear your list in the comments below. Are there any moments that I left out that you think needed to be on this list? If you liked the video, please take a moment and give the video a like and hit the subscribe button as well as the bell icon right next to it to be updated when I release new content. Thanks again to Oren the Elf for sponsoring the video. If you would like to sponsor a video, please check out my Patreon for more information and join my Discord server where we can have conversations about the series. The link is in the description below. Thanks again, everyone, and until next time, peace out.
Tinker in the kitchen with a job of work to do. Mistress up above, slipping on a rope of blue. She prances down the staircase, a fancy oh so free. Crying, Tinker, oh dear Tinker, won't you mend a pot for me? Tinker asks the mistress, don't you got a labour man? Yes, but she replied, he lacks your talent and your hands. And I can tell you got the skill to hit the spots you see. So, Tinker, oh dear Tinker, won't you mend a pot for me? Tinker said the neighbour boy could probably get it done. He's far too inexperienced, I'll never go that young. I'm sure he can be broken in or taught, but he's too sweet. So, Tinker, oh dear Tinker, won't you mend a pot for me? The mistress asked the tinker, can you help me move the chairs? They're just a bit too heavy and they need to go upstairs. She bats her eyes, the tinker sighs, then picks them up with ease. So, Tinker, manly tinker, won't you mend a pot for me?